Good morning. It's Tom Padula from Tom Padula TV on YouTube and Insegna Booksellers. And today is the last day of the financial year, Thursday the 30th of June 2022. So, you know, how much money have you made last year in 2021, 2022? This is the cutoff date, the 30th of June, and tomorrow we start a new financial year. But today, for me, is also the last day in which I do this world history continuously. I'm going to have a break from next week until the next one. I will resume again the world history series on Thursday, the 28th of July, 2022. You know, I need some time off now after all this. I would just want to remind you that these podcasts now are available on YouTube as well. The first five of all the, you know, the four, I do four a week, world history. Of course, Dante Alighieri, we're doing Purgatorio at the moment, but then there is also there's also Italian lessons, and of course French and Spanish together on the Friday. So all these ones here, the first five, I've put up on YouTube, also available to you through insegna.com in the blog section, and you go down there and you click the blog, and then you've got the subsections of each one of the programs, and also of course on Tom Padula .blogspot.com, and that's got a lot of other information and other things that I've produced over the years. Now, it's been quite a journey, really. This is program 40 for world history, Thursday the 30th of June. Yeah, program 40. And it's good, isn't it, to have achieved something and to be able to say I've completed that. But of course, history doesn't stop. We make it every day as we go along. The world keeps going, and so we do. We too come to an end. You know, in a way, it's the lot of humanity that we come, we stay for a while, and we go. In the sense of eternity, this is really a drop in the ocean. And what I'm going to do today? Well, basically today I'm going to continue from the Christianity, Eastern and Western empires, and the role of the churches in those times when Constantine, Emperor Constantine, did two things. One, he made the Roman Empire, if you like, a Christian empire, by making Christianity the state religion. Therefore, all the old gods had to go. So there must have been a lot of destruction of the various types of temples, etc., that the Romans were used to. But of course, when governments make decision, that doesn't mean that the population follows it 100%. And, you know, then we didn't have quick information. It was just by word of mouth, literally, and I banditori, you know, the people who went, you picked up on what the ruler wanted slowly but surely. And if you didn't do exactly what they said, then you would be punished severely. We've come a long way since then, but not in every country. Still, it's a lot better than it used to be. The world has gone a little bit softer, and some countries more than others, but we are moving towards a peaceful world, even though it doesn't look like that at the moment. We are definitely moving towards a peaceful world, because there are a lot of nations now that appreciate the fact that through our communication worldwide, through what I'm doing right now, to the ability to travel and the need for supply of goods and food, if you like, as well, around the world. So you need safe passages. So traveling has to be, you know, even there are rules to come in and out of a country, but you still can do it. But in a time of war, you can't. Everything gets destroyed. Things that, you know, one bomb falls on a shopping center. Disgusting. Boom. And how long did it take to have the shopping center built and then going? All right, we can do it again, sure. But how long does it... So the whole process of peace gets interrupted. And people lose confidence as well in each other and in each other's nations. And then, of course, people want to take revenge. And that's the worst thing you can do. But, you know, sometimes people who've lost relatives, families, you know, it's hard to forgive. Forgiveness, you know, and going on. Even forgiveness takes a bit of time. Anyway, enough of that. Now I'm going to go to the Eastern and Western empires and churches. Okay, so that's the end of the introduction. Don't forget, as I said, my next one after this one here, this will go into the podcast area. I'll keep putting them up on YouTube as I go on, but I'm going on holidays, so things will be disrupted for this month, and then I'll continue when I come. That's the plan, but these are the plans of mice and men. That's what I say. Well, will it happen? Who knows? Who knows? But for the moment, we've got this hour here. Let's do the best that we can with what we've got right in front of us. The Eastern and Western empires and churches. Constantine chose the old Greek city of Byzantium, or some people say Byzantium, on the Bosphorus. That's, you know, of course, we're talking about Turkey. Okay, and you can look it up. Where Europe and Asia meet as the new capital of the empire. And renamed it after himself, Constantinople. There you are. Nice to have a whole city named after you. The result was that the empire was soon divided into Eastern and Western halves, with capitals at Constantinople and Rome. So there's a division. But it wasn't, you know, a straight line. It works itself out. It's interesting, you know, I've been watching, as I said, I've been watching the Ertuğrul series on Netflix, The Resurrection of Ertuğrul, and it's quite a series, but it talks about the relationship between East and West in the 12th, 13th century, so we're 1,000 years away here. Okay, later the Christian church too was split with the Bishop of Rome, or Pope, as he came to be known, directing the Western church. So the Pope directed the Western church. And the Bishop of Constantinople, or Patriarch, they called him a Patriarch, ruling in the East. So that they had the rule, the spiritual part, but also they also had power over the estates as well. So they used their power for spirituality in a materialistic sense, where they interfered with the laws and they told the kings and emperors and the governments what to do. And they did. Okay, so that's where we are now with the division of the Roman Empire. Now, what happened here is that the Roman Empire decayed, they say decayed. In other words, once Christianity came to be, the church, the Roman Empire's official religion, there was a lot of trouble in the Western part, in Europe. A lot of the tribes that have been won over the years since Caesar, they had settled in the, you know, they spoke Latin, for example. They had good roads. They could travel. that could move within the empire a lot more easily during the Roman Empire itself, when it was well governed, than when it started to decay. Because, you know, if you built roads, etc., and you need to maintain them. So if the government is not strong, not collecting the taxes, etc., then what happens is that, there is a gradual but sure decay in the way the system works. We have it here as well. If we allow things to, we need renewals all the time. And Melbourne, for example, is very good at that. We are really good at renewing whole suburbs, and maintaining things as well. So very precise governance rules, local, state, and federal. Okay, everyone criticises, but the reality is that we travel safely on our road, again, with accidents, etc., but the roads are there. That's what used to happen during the Roman Empire, in a lot less than now, of course. The connections now are much more local and, statewide and national. They're very good. And I think in most countries of the world as well. When you got to Europe, that's what I see. Okay. Decay of the empire caused partly by slavery. And let's not forget that when there was a war, then the people who won, the victorious people, they took away all the gold, silver, but also they took away the people, the beautiful girls, the strong young men generally, because they had been in war, they would be cut out. So the children, older ones, women, they became slaves. And they had no rights in the empire because you had to be a Roman citizen in order to participate, not to be affected by the rule of the state. And then you had to be quite rich to be in the Senate and to then advise the emperor, if you wanted the advice, to actually give it to him. So the particular rules really occurred. So the decay of the empire caused partly by slavery. This division of the empire was a sign of weakness and decay. Rome and Constantinople had grown rich at the expense of the provinces because they collected taxes. Throughout the countryside, the small farms of the free peasants, who had once filled the ranks of the legions, had been converted into great estates worked by slaves. So if you had been a Roman soldier, you were given a grant of land and then you were given some slaves in order to help you with it. And you grew whatever and you paid your dues. But slaves cannot be trusted to fight for their masters. So there was a lot of problems there. Some, welcome to Assunta Lombardi. And thank you for coming on. So the slaves could not be trusted and they would not fight for their masters. I mean, if you ruled in a strong way, you're not going to follow. You expect people to direct you to what to do. So when they say, use your free will and fight for me, they say, why should we? If we get caught, we're still slaves. And so that's where the decay comes in. And then if the farms aren't worked properly, then they can't pay the taxes, and et cetera, et cetera. So there are consequences all the time. Fall of the Western Empire, 410 AD. Now, 313 AD, after Christ, Rome, Constantinople, made Christianity the official religion of the state of the Western Empire. That's 330, exactly within 100 years later, within 100 years. More and more, the Roman army came to be made up of barbarian mercenaries who also could not always be trusted to fight the kinsmen they had left on the other side of the frontiers. So they used the generals picked up and paid for the mercenaries. There weren't enough people to control all the lands, so they used some of the people to fight for them. But they had to fight the people where they came from. Well, if you ask me to fight against Montemuro, you know, it's better that the Australian government doesn't ask me. Because if they do, and I do, it's hard for... Some individuals can do it, and they do, and some other people can't. And so that's where... But in a dictatorship, you have to. So if a Ukrainian is in the Russian army, and there are many of them, and they don't fight against Ukraine, they get, you know... They get severely punished or killed. Who knows? I'm sure, as anyone asks the question, how many Russians are in the Ukrainian army and how many Ukrainians are in the Russian army? And what do they think of the current war? So you can see that there are problems there within, you know, within the organisation of the armies. Okay, so... The ones proud, so who also could not always be trusted to find the kinsmen they had left on the other side of the frontiers. In 410 AD, the once proud city of Caesar was captured and plundered by the Gothic barbarians and their king, Alaric. Now that's a good one. You can look up some film about Alaric, A-L-A-R-I-C, Alaric. He was a Gothic barbarian. But we also have Gothic columns in architecture. That's the goats, not goats, the goths, T-H-S, G-O-T-H-I-S, G-O-T-H-S, the goths, barbarians under the king Alaric. Okay, but the last service of Rome had been to spread Christianity. So they were told Christianity must become the state religion. Before the Western Empire fell, churches and monasteries had been founded everywhere in town and countryside. The temples had been converted to Christianity. Historians called the period following the fall of Rome the Dark Ages. Now, why dark? Because, you know, there wasn't much light shining on it. In terms of good government and, you know, even the ability to know about those times. There weren't many people. But the monks did start to write the history of Rome in those monasteries, etc., etc. So they built up their own little libraries here, there and everywhere. Because the heathen, barbarian invaders, blotted out civilization almost completely, but the flame of knowledge never quite died. And some of the heathens, some of the bad, you know, the barbarians who plundered and burned and killed, they could not eliminate the knowledge that came from Rome as an empire, no matter how much they tried. And after a few years, they too got converted to appreciate what had gone on before. So the church preserved some learning. Not all of it, but the church, the Christian church, preserved the learning from Rome. And that's 1,000 years later, the church, you know, we get the Renaissance. But the Eastern Empire did not suffer in the same way. They were much more... They didn't go through what the Western Empire of Rome went through. And that's why the divisions now, the politics now, are very different still in the Western part of Europe, you know, from Turkey onwards towards, you know, Paris and London and Rome, and the Eastern part. They're still... different mentalities developing. So, though many monks and priests in those days were almost as ignorant as their congregation, there were always some who kept alive the memory of Rome and who passed on enough fragments of knowledge for a new and nobler civilization to grow hundreds of years later on the ruins of the old. And so that's basically it for Rome. In my next chapter, when I come back, will be barbarian invasions of Europe. So we got to the English invasion of Britain, the Danes and Alfred, And I've been watching The Vikings on Netflix as well. And I suggest you do too before you come to listen to what I have to say. So that's it. That's it. When we come back, we're in the Dark Ages and Middle Ages. Okay, that's that. Now I need a drink. And then I will go to China. And China is here in front of you. I'm going to show you because I think it's important that we learn about China more and more. But to learn about China, we have to do something. We have to learn about the regions, like the regions of Italy. Here we are. There it is. Here from my tablet. Look at this. Okay. So these are the regions of China. Let's have a look at them. Heilong Gijang, with Harbin as the provincial capital. Then you've got Changchun, with Jilin. Jilin as with Changchun as the provincial capital. Then you've got Liaoning. And then there is, that's this one here. Let me get a pen so that I can show you what I'm talking about. I'm talking about here. Am I going to get here? I started up the top. Heilongjiang, Jilin, Liaoning. Then you got Beijing up the top there. And you got Beijing, Tramin. That's it's like in Europe, you've got Paris, you know what I mean? And then you've got the regions around it. And on to the north, there's the Mongol, the region of Mongolia. That's Mongolia here. But the Mongol part is on the top. That's where the Wall of China was built, all along here. Okay? And then you've got Shandong. You also got Shaanxi, Henan, Anhui, Zhejiang, Fujian, Guangdong, Guangxi, Zhuangzhou. I can't even pronounce them properly. Hunan, Hubei, Henan, Shaanxi, Hebei. And then there's, you know, the Beijing side is quite by itself. Shaanxi. There are, you know, provincial capitals there. Guangzhou. Chongqing. Well, Guizhou. Guangxi, I've said that before, next to Guangdong. Guangxi, Zhuangzhou, Zizikou. And with Nanning, the big cities, those ones there. Yunnan, Sichuan, Gansu. Now, this is the part not very much inhabited here. All this part here, all the concentration of the Chinese are here, near the sea, closer to the Pacific Ocean. Here, all this area here. Because, you know, between the sea and the land gives you a lot of possibility for trade. But this part here is not, this part of China is not, you know, it's more rural. Xizang, Ziziku, Kinsai, Xinjiang, Uyghur, Ziziku, the Uyghurs, that's where the, you know, the Chinese are from here. Beijing wants to control them. So they're different worlds, literally. And this is the Mongol part. Different, you know, different cultural traditions. And I'm sure here, King Gai doesn't escape it as well. Zizang, Ziziku. So the rulers are always interested in the areas that are empty. They want to control them easier. They send the army there are a few people, do whatever. In the cities, it's different. Okay, so that's the region of the regional history of China. All you have to do is bring it up and learn about them. And I intend to do that too as I move along. So that's that for now. And now I am going to come back to you, because there is also a bit more about China that I want to talk about today. And that's it's called Liu Bang and Jiangyu. Okay, here. See, there are Chinese history. Now, you know, you do research on this, but, you know, for me to learn it, it's a different ballgame again. I'm just going to read it to you. Okay, Liu Bang and Jiangyu. After the uprising led by Chen Sheng and Wu Guang failed, Liu Bang and Jiangyu continued to lead peasants against the Qin dynasty, Qin, in 2007 BC, before the birth of Christ. Jiangyu, with a small force, routed the main body of the Qin army at Yulu, southwest of today's Pingxiang in Hebei province. Hebei province is the one next to Beijing. So there you are. I'm starting to, you know, own some of the knowledge that I acquire as you go along. At the same time, Liu Bang's peasant army pressed on towards Xianyang and forced the abdication of the second Qin emperor. Jiangyu then proclaimed himself the king of Western Chu and made Liu Bang the king of Han. From 2006 BC, Jiangyu and Liu Bang fought for rule of the empire for nearly 4 years in what historians called the war between Chu and Han. At the beginning of the war, Jiangyu had an army of 400,000, whereas Liu Bang forces numbered only 100,000. But Liu Bang won the support of the common people by abolishing the draconian laws and decrees of the Qin dynasty and enforcing strict discipline on his troops. In addition, he had the assistance of able officials like Xia He, Zheng Liang and Han Xin, occupying the rich and fertile central Jiangxi Plain. The Han army, led by Liu Bang, gradually grew stronger. Jiangyu, in contrast, was arrogant and his army was lawless. Wherever they went, they lost the support of the people. They looted them, killed them, raped the women, you know, all sorts of things. In 2002 BC, the Han army besieged the Chu army in Gaijia, in today Hanui province. At a night, Jiangyu heard the Chu songs from the Han's army camps on all sides. Greatly astonished, he thought that the Chu regions had already been occupied by the Han army. He sadly bid farewell to his favourite concubine, Yu Ji, and escaped the encirclement with a small force, but was trapped at the Wujiang River in the northeast of today's Hexian County, Hanui Province, and committed suicide. Liu Bang then established the Han Dynasty, with Shangkan in the northwest of today Xian as the capital. It is historically called the Western Han Dynasty, and Liu Bang is known as Han Gao or Zhu. And I'm sure there will be films about this coming out of China. I'm sure of it. There's one here that the 2006 BC, Liu Bang conquered the capital Qi, Xianyang. Soon, Jiangyu's army of 400,000 soldiers were stationed at Ongmen, etc. That's the guy who had 400,000 in the army and lost to somebody at 100,000 soldiers. Can you imagine? So arrogance doesn't pay. Putin, you're not going to last. You cannot win unless you have the people are with you. And at the moment, it looks as if the Russian people can't do much to remove, wherever they are, the dictators. Dicto, I say, you follow. That's where dictator comes from the Latin word dicto. Okay, so on that note, well, we've done this part here. Now we have to go to the next lot, which is our own indigenous history before the invasion. And before the invasion, I have here we go. This was the part dealing with children, childhood. Okay, and we had here some notes about two children of Tasmania, which I read, and now we'll keep going. Trugger Nana didn't want to stay at the fire. She wanted to collect oysters too. That was a little child. Taking one of her mother's spare bags, she tied it on her shoulders like a knapsack and ran after the women. She scrambled up the rocks just as the women dived down. Quick as a flash, she followed them. The cold water made her gasp, but she went down and down to the oyster beds. She tried to pry them free. Her lungs hurt as she gave up and rose to the surface. She had managed to collect only a dozen shellfish. The other women were still underwater. So, in other words, the women went underwater to collect the shellfish, and they could stay down there for a long period of time. Whilst the men went out collecting, kangaroos and etc. Woradi reached the men as they brought the big kangaroo to bay. One wily hunter dashed behind the animal. Grabbing the tail, he jerked it up and it tumbled head first to the ground. The men rushed in and clubbed the animal to death. Another kangaroo broke cover and the men raced after it. Woradi was too tired to follow. He returned to the camp and played with the other boys. Separating into two groups, they stood apart and hurled their toy spears at each other. So they were, following, they had to learn how to throw spears and boomerangs and all that. The aim of the game was to stand as still as possible as the spear whizzed towards you. Then with a quick twist of the body, you tried to avoid being hit. Woradi was good at the game and twisted this way and that until a spear whammed him a glancing blow. Giving a yelp, he decided he didn't like the game and raced to the fire. Piling wood on it, he sat and waited for his parents and sister to return. The women came strolling back with bulging bags. They were laughing at one of the younger women who had been nipped by a crayfish. When the men came in bringing half a dozen kangaroos and wallabies, the crayfish were already baking in the coals. The fires were heaped up and the animals flung on the coals. Beautiful barbecue, huh? Everyone began feasting and enjoying themselves. The sun went down and the moon came up and the rest. Tonight a big dance was to be held. The men began miming the hunt. One became the kangaroo and the others aimed mock spears and struck it down. One hunter aped a clumsy and everyone laughed except the one being mimed. He scowled. Well, then joined in the laughter. At last, Truganana and Woradi went into the shelter to sleep. It had been a tiring day, but the girl still had the energy to brag about her diving, even though she came up earlier. Woradi wasn't listening. He wandered far in a dream where he speared the biggest kangaroo of all. Welcome to Curtis L. Tolman. There you are. That is before the invasion, and that's how children played during the time before the invasion, before Captain Arthur Phillips came to here. Now I've done all that, and now it's time for the colonials. We can't have the indigenous, the First Nations people have all their way because we're here as well. We are here. No one can say to us that we're not in Australia. And the longer you live here and the more you bury your dead in this country, the more the country becomes yours. The land owns you. My parents are in Preston. Down. When I got to Montemurro, they're not there. anymore. They're here. My children were born here. But I respect my Italian identity. I speak it. I breathe and live it every day. But I speak English all the time. And I'm interested in other countries preserving, you know, the children here in Australia, preserving their identities with those, with their family members from overseas, because they are the bridges to all the countries of the world. And we had a good experience in Sydney with the Olympics, because when you've got people who speak, you know, speak the language, but there were a lot of first generation people then who spoke the original languages, like me. Now, but anyone who's second, third generation Italian background, if you don't learn the language properly and you're learning about the history and, you know, you don't have that connection, you lose it over time. If you don't use it, you lose it. That's basically it. Okay, now here it is. How Gilbert died. This is from our friend Banjo Patterson. Have you noticed that my cold went thanks to the chicken soups? You know, that's important. Chicken soup, when you're not, you get a bit of a cold, it's winter time, you know, all the heat within the house, and then you go out in the cold, it's unavoidable. And don't call it what you think it is, because a lot of times it's not. Okay, how Gilbert died. There's never a stone at the sleeper's head, there's never a fence beside, and the wandering stock on the grave may tread unnoticed and undenied. But the smallest child on the watershed can tell you how Gilbert died. Who is Gilbert? For he rode at dusk with his comrade Dunn to the hut at the Stockman's Ford in the waning light of the sinking sun. They peered with a fierce accord. They were outlaws both. They were outlaws. And on each man's head was £1,000 reward. They were nice people, Gilbert and Dunn. They had taken toll of the country round, and the troopers came behind with a black that tracked like a human hound in the scrub and the ranges blind. A tracker, generally an Aboriginal, who knew the country. He could run the trail where a white man's eye no sign of a track could find. He had hunted them out of the One Tree Hill and over the Old Man Plain. But they wheeled their tracks with a wild beast skill, and they made for the range again. Then away to the hut where their grandsire dwelt, they rode with a loosened rein. And their grandsire gave them a greeting bold. Come in and rest in peace. No safer place does the country hold. With the night pursuit must cease, and we'll drink success to the roving boys and to hell with the black police. So they were backed up by, you know, the people in the country, in the bush. But they went to death when they entered there, in the hut of the Stockman's Ford, for their grandsire's words were as false as fair. They were betrayed. They were doomed to the hangman's cord. He had sold them both to the black police for the sake of the big reward. He wanted £1,000. In the depth of night, there are forms that glide as stealthy as serpents creep. And around the hut where the outlaws hide, they plant in the shadows deep. And they wait till the first faint flush of dawn shall waken their prey from sleep. But Gilbert wakes while the night is dark, a restless sleeper, aye. He has heard the sound of a sheepdog's bark and his horse's warning neigh. And he says to his mate, there are hawks abroad, and it's time that we went away. Their rifles stood at the stretch ahead, their bridles lay to hand. They wakened the old man out of his bed when they had heard the sharp command. In the name of the Queen, lay down your arms. There, Dunn and Gilbert, stand. Then Gilbert reached for his rifle true, that close at his hand he kept. He pointed straight at the voice and drew, but never a flash outleaped, out leapt, for the water ran from the rifle breech. It was drenched while the outlaw slept. Then he dropped the piece with a bitter oath, and he turned to his comrade Dunn. "We are sold," he said. "We are dead men both, but there may be a chance for one. I'll stop and I'll fight with the pistol here. You take to your heels and run." That's beautiful. So Dunn crept out of on his hands and knees in the dim half-dawning light, and he made his way to patch of trees and vanished among the night. And the trackers hunted his tracks all day, but they never could trace his flight. Never found him. But Gilbert walked from the open door in a confident style and rash. He heard at his side the rifles roar and he heard the bullets crash. But he laughed as he lifted his pistol hand and he fired at the rifle flash. Then out of the shadows the troops aimed at his voice and the pistol sound. While the rifle flashes, the darkness flamed. He staggered and spun around and they riddled his body with rifle balls as it lay on the blood-soaked ground. There's never a stone at the sleeper's head. There's never a fence besides, and the wandering stock on the grave may tread unnoticed and undenied. But the smallest child on the watershed can tell you how Gilbert died. So he was a hero. He saved his mate, and he died. He went to his death, to the black police, the police. What a beautiful story. That one there, how Gilbert died, could be made into a film, is it? That's another one that can be made into a film. Henry Lawson, now. You remember the drovers? I'll only read a bit because this is a long story. Henry Lawson is a short story, but his short stories run for many pages. This is very small writing, from 19 page to 26. So that's 7 pages. But very small writing. Here, I'll show you. That's how small it is, the writing. And this is The Drover's Wife, okay, by Benjamin Patterson. Very good. And I think this one has been made into a film. I'm sure of it. But here, I'll just read a little bit more, because you remember she was left on her own with her children in a hut, and a snake came in, and her 11-year-old child wanted to kill it with a big stick. So the drover's wife makes the children stand together near the doghouse while she watches for the snake. She gets 2 small dishes of milk and sets them down near the wall to tempt it to come out. But an hour goes by and it does not show itself. It is near sunset and a thunderstorm is coming. The children must be brought inside. She will not take them into the house, for she knows the snake is there and may at any moment come up through the cracks in the rough slab floor. So she carries several armfuls of firewood into the kitchen and then takes the children there. The kitchen has no floor, or rather an earthen one, called a ground floor, in this part of the bush. There is a large, roughly made table in the centre of the place. She brings the children in and makes them get on this table. They are 2 boys and 2 girls, mere babies. She gives them some supper, and then before it gets dark, she goes into the house and snatches up some pillows and bedclothes, expecting to see or lay a hand on the snake any minute. She makes a bed on the kitchen table for the children and sits down beside it to watch all night. She has an eye on the corner and a green sapling club laid in readiness on the dresser by her side, together with a sewing basket and a copy of the young lady's journal. She has brought the dog into the room. Tommy turns in under protest, but says he lay awake all night and smashed at the blinded snake. Tommy's the 11-year-old boy. His mother asks him how many times she has told him not to swear. He has his club with him under the bedclothes. And Jackie protests, "Mummy, mummy, Tommy's skinning me alive with his club. Make him take it out." Tommy, "Shut up, you little. Do you want to be bit with a snake?" Jackie shuts up. "If your brother," says Tommy after a pause, "you'll swell up and smell and turn red and green and blue all over till you're bust. Won't he, mother?" "Now then, don't frighten the child. Go to sleep," she says, because trying to teach the young ones to respect him. The two younger children go to sleep, and then Jackie complains of being squeezed. More room is made for him. Presently, Tommy says, "Mother, listen to them, little possums." He calls them possums. "I'd like to screw their blanky necks." And Jackie protests drowsily, "But they don't hurt us, the little blanks." In other words, the possums are up on the roof as well. "Mother, there, I told you, you'd teach Jackie to swear." But the remark makes her smile. Jackie goes to sleep. Presently, Tommy asks, "Mother, do you think they'll ever extricate the kangaroo?" "Lord, how am I to know, child? Go to sleep. Will you wake me if the snake comes out?" "Yeah, go to sleep." "Okay, and I'm going to stop there. It's near midnight. So I'm going to stop near midnight. And I'll continue that. Don't forget, I'll come back. The plan is on the 28th of July. Thursday. I'll come back and I'll continue from there." So that's that. Now, it's the time I love the most, when I finished all my obligations and I got to my own work. In other words, I got to the Italian clubs, and I'll also show you Sovereign Hill. There should be enough time. But there's a lot of music as well, so I'm hoping to finish it off. Let's see. Always the same thing. Whenever I... one. Don't get it wrong, Tom. Yes, I got it. Straight away this time. Getting better at this. That's all. Now I have to look up. What do I have to look up? 21. Here we go. They call this poro poro, something like that. It's a dance. Solanina Social Club. Poro poro poro. That's a lovely, they're called poro poro popo, whatever. Okay, now this next one is a longer one. This was at the end of the night. I thought they were going to finish within a couple of dances. They went on for quite a while. They know how to enjoy themselves, huh? Solarino Social Club. And that's the band. No Limits. There's Joe on the left, Tony, and then on the accordion is Ross. There we are. Even the guys are playing the... dancer there. Look at that. That's how you keep fit in your third age. Dancing. There are some younger ones too, but very few. There you are. Wow, isn't it magnificent, huh? That's good. I just want to see where I am at. Where am I at? There, okay. Now, the next one is an even better one. Here we are. Come on. Whoop. Oh, no. Oh, no, I pressed the wrong button. Oh, gosh. I've got to go back now. Oh, well, you just got to put up with me now. Sorry. I pressed the wrong button. I have to wait now for this to come back. Oh, here it is. Whew, lucky. Now, oh, I have to go back to where I was here on the screen. And you're on as well. So let's hope that I can do it. I can do it. Yes. Yes, I can do it. Have I done it? So I played. Which one did I play? I played this one here, that one there. I played this one here. I think it's this one. Yes, here we go. Wow. Tintarella di Luna. Don't forget, when I do this, I make mistakes. La di luna, tira della colorata. There you are, shake it. Raggi di luna, tin tin tin. Baciano te su una candida come te. Some of the people know the songs, and it's great when they sing it and dance at the same time. Quite a dancer, that one. Oh. That came from nowhere, that image. That's Joe. Oh, hello, Angela. Welcome. Finish. Now, that was Tintarella di Luna, which is a song which people can and should learn off by heart, because it's always sung almost every dinner dance I attend. So you can sing it when you're dancing and you're Tintarelli di Luna, you can sing it with the singer. Be beautiful idea. Okay, so the next one here is, let's have a look. Cuore Matto. Another one. A pretty woman. Sorry. Wrong one. Ross is happy. Mind you, this was after 11:30. This one could have gone on all night. That's Pretty Woman. What does that show you, though? It shows that our bands actually have this bilingual thing with the songs as well. That, you know, it's sort of bringing in a lot of other musical styles, and I'd like to see more coming from different countries as well. The occasional one, you know, it sort of it should add to the multicultural nature of our society here in Melbourne, in Australia, at least. It's good. The next one. Now that's Cuore Matto. It's a Tony Singh. Nice choir.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Cuore matto. There, cuore matto. That was a nice one too. Now, this one here, let me see how much I've got. I've got two more there. Now, there's too much still going on. I won't be able to. I'll just show you. I'll do this one here. No, I better do the other one. So, I'll finish off with cuore matto. Cuore matto. Okay. Finished off. That's for next time with cuore matto. Now, of course, I've put all this on Facebook, my Facebook page, and I'll just repeat again. I won't be coming back to this world history lesson. This is world history lesson number 40. And I'll start again, I'll not continue with the world history, series from Thursday. When will it be? The Thursday, the 28th, I think it's the 28th of July. Okay, so that's when I'm taking a break from this all. But before I take a break, I want to show you. Yes. I want to show you something from, was it 2018? Yes. This Sovereign Hill. Where am I? Come on, Tom. Here we are. Okay, now we've finished off with, I think, the fire brigade picture. When I was in fire brigade picture, if I can find it, then I'll just continue from there. Fire brigade. I don't know. Fire brigade picture. No. Oh, I've done it again. I went off again. Oh, my God. Okay, I have to, come on. Oh, it's unbelievable how this happens. I'm determined to show you Sovereign Hill. Okay, here we go. Okay, slowly but surely. You just need patience with this. Fire. Oh, here we are. We got it. Now, this is Sovereign Hill. We stopped at the fire brigade last week and we'll continue. Now, this is easy because I can just do this and show you a slide. Empire Bowling Saloon. That's the way. Yeah, the beautiful Sovereign Hill. And apparently they've got something very special with lights now. And, of course, I can't go, but anyway. See, that's another place, where another game. Please bowl from here. Good one. applied. It's Filippo. Filippo, he won. And that's, you know, the way there used to be the old furniture from the... And I went in there because this is like a little museum. I actually interviewed the guy, and then I interviewed this guy here. This is for Tom Vedula TV.
Yes.
On YouTube and Channel 31. And I'm here at Soren Hill, and I visit the local school. What's your name?
Sir.
Sir?
Yes.
Just Sir?
Sir. That's how that's what the children call me, Sir, is Sir.
So here is Sir, and he's going to explain to us what is the educational situation here at Soren Hill.
So at Soren Hill, we have five of our costume schools where the children from across the region will come here and have a 3-day or 2-day program dressed as an 1850s student being taught 1850s curriculum. So this is one of our schools. This is the Ragged School. Yes. And across the road, we have the Wesleyan Chapel.
Yes.
The St. Peter's School is across on Speeble Street, at the end of Speeble Street.
Yes.
The Red Hill National School.
Fantastic.
And also the St. Alepius Chapel down in the diggings. So there are five different schools we have at the museum.
Now, I noticed that in 1854, there's a gentleman called Raffaele Carboni.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, but you don't teach Italian here.
No, there was lots of Italians on the goldfield.
Exactly.
Raffaele Carboni was one of the most well-known for his... input at the
He wrote the Eureka Stockade book, which you don't have, and I have.
Oh, right.
I have one. So yes. Next time I come to Soren Hill, I'll bring you one.
Oh, we may have one, sir, in our collection. You never know. I'll have to find out.
I don't know.
So we have around 15,000, between 13,000 and 15,000 children come here and participate in our costume program.
Yes.
And we have 100,000 children participate in our education program. Which are our day programs that we offer here.
That's
in the
fantastic.
Museum.
Do you have a library here?
We do, yes.
Of the Eureka Stockade?
There's many books. Yeah. I don't know how many is in there, but there'd be quite a few thousand. Yeah. And we have an historian.
And where is it exactly?
Oh, sir! Sir's here, sir.
Oh, I've already filmed the gentleman. Is this the gentleman?
This is
the inspector.
This is...
Okay, stop. Well, I'll stop it there. And... Well, what happened there is that I interviewed the other guy and my film ran out or something went wrong. I don't have the interview. So we walked out of there and we continue our tour of Soren Hill. There is here. Beautiful. Lots and lots of interesting places. There it is there. Look at that. The gold, the various animals. Look at that. Huh? Birds, shells, fantastic stuff. Filippo was very interested. He comes from Monopoly in Puglia, and Maria Luisa is now settled in Australia, and she sells almond milk. And, you know, Filippo was quite a businessman in Monopoly in Puglia, in Italy. And I've been there a couple of times now, near the beach, beautiful. That's Maria Luisa there, a great person, really and truly. And this is where they made gold, I think. Did we go there too for the gold? Yes, they made gold nuggets. This one here, well, I'm sorry, I didn't turn the pictures around, so I'll just go faster. Hats. Ah, what a pity. I've got to fix this up. Never mind. You can still see it sideways. Turn your television around. Okay, we're back on track now. Oh, no, not back on track now again. Again, umbrellas. More umbrellas and hats. Tall hats. Oh, well, your dog loves your new whatever. Good one. I think it's one of the theatres. They had a little show there and we went to see it. And that's the ceiling. How beautiful is that? I'll have to fix this up. Sorry, people. But at least that's the show. There we are. Good to go around. I love it. Oh, what a beautiful place. Look at that. This is the rocks, a rock collection. Of course, you need to eat as well. That's a nice place. There you are. And seen this picture? That's a nice one. Filippo and Maria Luisa. I'll have to send it to him. There's me in the corner there, but my skill at selfies changed over the years. A good one. Another good one. There you are, corn. And these are donkeys. If you want to go around the old-fashioned way. And they made, see that? Still making them. Workshops, huh? Old-fashioned way. Of course, when you go out, you have to take pictures. Otherwise, you don't remember anything. Outside. Fire. I like that. Whiskey barrels. The old little cars, huh? There you are, look at that. Just to set this up. Outside. There we are. National school. Well, listen, I've gone over time. I'm going to stop there at national school and I'm going to say goodbye to you now. Okay. Well, it's been quite an hour and I've gone over time now, but it's the last podcast, the presentation, lesson, whatever you want to call it. And I want to bid you farewell and hope that you have a good July, and I'll see you again on Thursday, the 28th of July. Thank you for following me for a while. I really enjoy having people coming on when I have this live events, because it is an event. I put a bit of work into it, and it's worth it, really and truly. Okay, this is Tom Padula from Tom Padula TV on YouTube and Insegna Booksellers, of course. Okay, ciao, arrivederci, next time. Okay, 28th, don't forget. Bye for now.